This episode of Artist Decoded is brought to you by No Wave Academy. No Wave Academy offers college-level art courses at a fraction of the price. Learn from some of today's best contemporary and fine artists. Artist Decoded is offering 10% off of all of their online courses. Go to No Wave Academy, that's NOHWaveAcademy.com. Type in AD10, all caps, at checkout for 10% off. They recently released a figure composition basics course taught by master oil painter Aaron Westerberg. They also recently released a course entitled Layering the Portrait in Oils, taught by recent Artist Decoded guest Mia Bergeron. So go to nohwaveacademy.com, that's NOHWaveAcademy.com, type in AD10, all caps, at checkout for 10% off. Now, on to the episode.
Connecting to nature is the fastest way to connect to your subconscious and to get underneath at what's really happening. And I think that's really like a lot of what my work is about. It's about painting the what's happening in the unseen.
Hey everyone, welcome to Artist Decoded. This is your host Yoshino, and you are listening to episode number 160 with abstract painter and artist Janna Watson. Let me first read you a portion of her bio to give you an overarching sense of the feeling and intention behind her work. Canadian painter Janna Watson uses abstraction as both an escape from and return to the real. As the world we know dematerializes into paint strokes, so too does her paint take stage as its very own character in a multi-act drama of composition. Bundles of color, made up of discrete yet inseparable instances of pigment, what Watson refers to as quote-unquote moments, are teemed and poised as though caught mid-multiplication. Sweeps of paint redirect sharply and fold over themselves. Thin, rigid ink lines cut into the pictorial field as rudimentary elements in an increasingly complex system of painterly language. All the components play out on a surface of slow chromatic gradation. Like many of Watson's players, these backdrops tenderly gesture toward the familiar, stopping just short of representation. The result is a conceptual project and distinct stylistic signature that speaks to a contemporary milieu in which abstract painting is not the retreat of meaning into an unrecognizable realm, but rather the emergence of medium as a quote-unquote figure in its own self-described world of feeling and beginning. Watson does more than reveal paint's potential to emote. She gives it a space to reveal itself in its own time. So I find that there's a really interesting symbiotic relationship between her artwork and her life, and the overlap between her experiences, which enter into her work in general. But, you know, I think that it was really great that Janna was extremely vulnerable and honest during this conversation. We talked about her growing up in a small town of less than 700 people, where she had a deep connection to her Pentecostal upbringing, and how her father was a pastor to the local Pentecostal church. I also wanted to preface that after this interview, Janna wanted to let everyone know that our conversation regarding religiosity, specifically toward the Christian faith, are spoken purely from her own personal experiences, and that she in no way is trying to talk down about Christianity as a whole. In fact, she brings up certain parts of Christianity, especially in regards to the morals that played a huge part in her life in the respect of shaping her as a person and also shaping a certain amount of empathy towards other people. And we touch upon the emotions underneath the surface of her artwork, how the abstraction resonates not only in the aesthetic of her artwork, but throughout the complexities of life itself. And we go deep in this episode, tying together how instances in her life have shaped her and her artwork, and how the overlap of these feelings and emotions coalesce into this beautiful melange of colors, which radiates into her own sinew of a complex form of sorts. And yeah, you know, I really appreciated to have Jan on this episode, and I think that every one of you will highly enjoy this episode. But before we begin, I would love to give a shout out to the support of our sponsors from Savoir Faire, who are importers of materials for the fine arts such as Sennelier, Fabriano, Raphael, and Isabey. For more information, follow Art Savoir Faire on Instagram and Facebook. And I just want to speak of the team over at Savoir Faire because they are extremely thoughtful with the people that they choose to represent and sponsor. And I have conversations with their team every week about how to improve the arts and how to improve the message of the arts. So they're more than just a paint distribution company. They're really championing the art movement itself. And that's why I really appreciate their support for helping out this podcast and for helping out us over at No Wave as well. So definitely go check out their website. It's savoirfaire.com. Also, if you have the time, since I know you're listening to this on the phone, at least I would assume you are listening to this on the phone, go to our iTunes page, leave us that review. It really helps reviewers like yourself to listen to this podcast. Just go right there to the 5-star button and smash that sucker right into the screen textural abyss that it is. I would greatly appreciate that, and much love to everyone for the continued support and for all of the kind messages that everyone's left for us. So yeah, without further ado, here it is, episode number 160 with painter Janna Watson. Hope you enjoy it. Thanks so much, Janna, for coming onto the podcast, and I appreciate you taking the time. So just jumping into it a bit, we were talking earlier about you growing up in a really small town and how your father was a Pentecostal pastor. And I guess, can you talk about that a little bit and, you know, what it was like to grow up in a town with less than 700 people in it?
Growing up in a small town, it's not totally northern Ontario, but a bit more northern than it's about 2 hours north of Toronto. My father's a Pentecostal pastor, and I would say that growing up in Flesherton, there's a lot of great things about growing up in a small town, but I would say that my family was extremely religious and very fundamental. So there was a lot of fear-based religiosity growing up. And, you know, we had two stations, and there wasn't a lot of exposure, I guess you could say, to the rest of the world. So you're kind of living in a bubble of what your parents are telling you is true. But in other ways, it was amazing because you have all this nature and you have your imagination, and there's just so many different things to do.
Were you able to, when you were growing up, be able to go into the woods and connect with nature in that way? And did you utilize that as an escape from the reality of living in a small town, or what would you use that as?
Yeah, well, I would definitely say that it contributed to my being introverted. There's a lot of just, I think what I'm trying to say is that growing up in a small town, because you don't have a lot of outside influences, you don't have different kids that are just telling you different things, and you don't have the TV, that there's just, you just kind of get stuck in a bubble. And I think I grew up a little bit in a bubble. And I think also, as far as growing up in a church, there was a bit of a bubble there. So I think that I would say that I grew up in a bit of a naive atmosphere. But at the same time, because I had that faith element, there was a lot of imagination. There's a lot of, I mean, faith literally is just like believing in what you can't see. And there was a lot of that. And a lot of it was really scary because there's like demons and there's hell and there's heaven and there's like the rapture, which is, you know, Jesus is coming back and he's going to take everyone. He's going to take all the Christians and leave the sinners. So there's a lot of this just like kind of unknown everywhere. So there's a lot of imagination, and some of it was extremely good and some of it was just extremely fear-based.
So then, speaking of the religiosity aspects, were there a lot of, I guess, preachings of what you would call fire and brimstone teachings in the Pentecostal church?
Yes. We did this play called Heaven's Gates and Hell's Flames. I don't know if you've heard of that.
Mm-mm.
Which is, it's just literally depicting, like, if you don't have Jesus in your heart, what's going to happen to you? Like, you're going to get thrown into hell. There's also, there was these shows that came out in the 70s that actually completely terrified me. And it terrified my brother. It was basically what's going to happen in the end days, in the apocalypse, when Jesus comes back and raptures all of his saints. And if you aren't living a Christian life, you get left behind. So there was all these movies out. I forget what the series was called. Sometimes I'd come home from school, and if my parents weren't there, I would think that I got left behind. And my brother would also have these nightmares about, you know, we just got left behind and we're eating muffins in a forest and we're running away from the Antichrist. So there was just this phase, I would say it was probably late 80s, where my dad was showing these videos of, you know, just what's going to happen. And it was terrifying. I talked to some of my friends who went through the church, and I think everyone still has a little bit of PTSD from that.
Yeah, definitely. I can imagine. Did your parents, I mean, I'm assuming that you did have a TV.
Yes.
Did your parents control what content you would be consuming on the television, or how would that be?
Yeah, there was definitely some control, but we also only had two stations. So there wasn't a need to control, because there just wasn't a lot of reception.
Really?
Yeah.
That's really interesting.
Yeah. I think it was TVO and CBC, maybe.
Wow. So then, now that you've had time to process a lot of those things that you've been through, have you had really in-depth conversations with your brother about the experiences that you both went through during that time period as children?
Yeah, we've definitely been able to reflect back, and just, it's really nice, you know, when you go through an experience and you have someone who went through that experience with you. So that memory isn't just, you know, you creating this narrative of a memory of fragmented memories, but it's just like someone is there to confirm that that indeed happened. So yeah, we've definitely talked about it and processed it, which is really nice to have that.
Yeah. You know, I don't want to necessarily make this all about the religiosity. It's just something that I feel is important to understand as your perspective in life and your perspective on your art, because the childhood is, and experiences that you have as a kid, they have profound effects on how you are today, whether that's positively or negatively or just an amalgamation of all those things, right? So I'm curious, is your father still a Pentecostal pastor now?
Yes, he is.
Hmm. And when you have conversations with him in regards to your artwork and just you and your life now, I mean, you know, we were talking earlier on the phone, you know, that you came out and, you know, having those sort of conversations with him in a small town, how do you think that affected you?
Okay, so my dad is still a Pentecostal pastor, and we have a lot of conflicting views on my lifestyle. And there's a lot of things that we just don't agree on, and we never will. But I can say the one thing about my father is that he, and I think the one thing that really I've brought with me is just the love of nature and the magic in nature. My dad's a beekeeper, and he's also a gardener. Growing up, he was the head of beautification for Flesherton, the small town. And I always kind of just like, he's just an extremely artistic and creative man. So even though there's this like hellfire brimstone thing going on, underneath is this beautiful spirituality. I've taken that with me, just really sweet sensitivity and openness to nature. So it's kind of this dichotomy of, you know, the Bible doesn't agree with this and we don't agree with it, but it's also like there's this other side that's like there's a lot of love and a lot of acceptance there. And so I cannot say that it's been easy, especially realizing that I was gay when I was 18. I was actually in a very religious program called Master's Commission, and in that program, you're not dating, you're memorizing the Bible, you're not listening to secular music, you're not watching TV. It's just like a complete dedication to God. Mm. And that is where I ended up falling in love with my best friend, which kind of threw me for a bit of a loop. And it was not easy. It was not easy at all. There was a lot of questions and questioning the Bible and questioning everything. And I'm actually really grateful that I went through that experience, because it did make me question things. Because I was like, all of a sudden the Bible wasn't making sense, because it's not something that I chose. It's not, you know, the Bible is telling me that you make these decisions to fall in sin. But I was like, I'm definitely not making these decisions to feel this way. And what is that about? So I started really questioning the Bible. I started researching, took my dad's lexicon, which is just totally dissecting the Greek version of the Bible and really getting into the religious context, the cultural context of the Bible. And then that's where I was just like, okay, not everything's making sense. So coming out really made me question everything that I had grown up believing.
I'm really curious. So when you fell in love with your best friend, you said that was around when you were 18 years old, correct?
Yes.
Did you tell her that you were in love with her?
Not at first. It probably took me a good 2 years. But at first, like, what I did was, like, I fasted, which is not eating, and I prayed, and I went up to the altar, and I repented, because I was just feeling so much shame. And I can wholeheartedly say that I did everything that my religion at the time would have told me to do to get rid of these feelings, and nothing worked.
Yeah, I mean, I don't want to sprinkle in my personal anecdotes too much in this, but I think we had a conversation about this prior, and I grew up in a Christian environment from first grade until the end of high school, except for 1 year in high school. And just being in that environment, and granted it wasn't Pentecostal, but there was a lot of shame involved with having seemingly humanistic just traits, you know, and humanistic desires. And I don't know. It's really interesting, because there, like you were talking about with this dichotomy, and, you know, I feel that there are so many things that exist within these dualities, and nothing is like the fire and brimstone teachings that your father has been taught, potentially, I would assume, a majority of his life, and he's distilling through his practice in you and your brother and, you know, and the community. And also how he's, as you describe, a very sensitive person and artistic. And, you know, so I don't think it's always that, you know, Christians are this particular way, or, you know, Pentecostal Christians are this particular way. But I also think it's interesting, this idea of empathy and having humanistic empathy, and, you know, because you are his daughter. And so for you to be able to come to these understandings of yourself in an honest fashion, and being able to have to relay that to him, I think, you know, it's beautiful, first of all, but it's also something that I could imagine could be very contradictory to the way he thinks just in general, because Christianity, being gay is technically a sin.
Yes.
And I'm curious, like, how you dealt with those feelings at first and how that translated into your artwork.
I think at first there was a lot of, because of the shame and because I believed that it wasn't right, and I was just really confused. I do remember a solid point where I kind of accepted it. Like, I was like, okay, I thought at first that God, this is kind of funny. I thought that because I didn't really understand it, and I went on a few dates with these guys, and I was like, okay, it seems like God has given me the gift of celibacy because I'm just not into this. But then I was like, oh, okay, I'm just a big dyke. But there was actually a moment. Where I had fought it so much, and I was just exhausted because I'd done everything I could to try to get rid of these feelings. And then I was just like, okay, like I'm a lesbian. I'm kind of putting the pieces together. This is who I am. And I think in that moment, I also just kind of accepted myself and I accepted the feelings that I was having because I was like in full-time war. Every time something came into my head or into my heart, I was just like at war with myself and it was exhausting. So there was a moment where I would say that moment might be you could maybe call it surrender, where I was just like, okay, this is just it. This is the feelings that I'm having. And I think that a lot of what I've taken with me through my childhood and then into my practice today is that surrender of just like kind of accepting the mystery of life and just being like, you know what, I am not in control right now. I've done everything I can. I'm exhausted and I'm just kind of letting go. And I would say that at mm-hmm. first, after I came out, I also discovered alcohol, which was great in mm-hmm. the beginning because it just kind of calmed my nervous system and helped me to open up, and I was making more friends. So I've realized now I've kind of done a full circle lately because I just quit drinking a couple years ago. Mm-hmm. And I think that after I was just so confused about God because I realized that I was a gay, and I kind of left God in this way because things were just not lining up. And I started drinking and things were great. Like I just started making friends, and I'm definitely shy and an introvert. And I all of a sudden was just feeling a little bit liberated, or a lot liberated. And then kind of full circle is like lately, like 2 years ago, I was like, I just feel so spiritually deprived. I started using alcohol as a crutch for that void of my spiritual life, I guess. Mm-hmm. And the past couple of years, just like getting alcohol, just taking it out of my life, I've just realized how much I replaced God with alcohol. Because I was just like, you know, I'm kind of really hurt. I'm hurt by what the church did because they, you know, I had really dedicated my life to God. And I also I used to play the piano in church, and all of a sudden I wasn't allowed to do that. And that in the beginning was the way that I really expressed myself creatively. And so there's a lot of anger and a lot of confusion. And I think I just kind of numb myself out. And yeah, it's kind of been full circle. And I've just realized like how much I need that, like I need that spiritual connection. A lot of I don't really know how to describe this, but it's definitely, I've become more aware of it in my work and in my process.
Become aware of what aspects?
I think just like the importance of spirituality and being aware of, I guess, just that surrender and that having faith and believing in the unknown and just kind of touching into that, because my work is very abstract and it's really a reflection of energy and connectedness. So I really am since I quit drinking, there's just this different connection and materiality that I've found in my work. I actually used to cover paintings with a coat of resin. I'm not sure if you know what that is. It's just it's kind of this like glossy finish. And around the same time I quit drinking, I stopped using the resin because they were kind of correlated, I think, because I use the resin as this kind of like, it's kind of shiny and kind of sexy. And it kind of also, it glosses over the materiality and it kind of hides some maybe what I might call flaws in the work. And it was around that same time that I was just like, you know what, it was extremely vulnerable for me. I don't even know why, because it's, you know, the work is still the work. It was just like a finish. But now I use just varnish on top of everything, and it just shows the authenticity of the material. And I feel like that is kind of what I was doing in my life at the time, where I was just kind of like, okay, this is it. This is everything that I'm using. I'm not hiding behind alcohol. I'm not, using something to kind of give me energy or to help me be a little bit more extroverted. This is it.
I mean, it sounds like, you know, once you came out, that if I'm hearing this correctly, do you feel that you were rejected from the church in a way? And then essentially what it sounds like is that you traded one religion, which is being Pentecostal Christian, to alcohol almost. It's like trading a religion for another religion in a way.
Yeah.
But I also think it's really fascinating how the way that you process these feelings, they can be translated into the artwork. And in hindsight, you can disassemble that and understand that you're essentially, it's almost like a direct metaphor. It's, you know, you're like glossing over the thing that you're dealing with.
Yeah.
With the resin.
Right.
You know, it's almost a physical and visual metaphor in a way.
Exactly.
And when you did come out, did you feel rejected from the church?
For sure. Yeah. I remember being in a church service, actually, and there's about 2,000 people. It was in Brampton. Mm-hmm. And the leader of this Christian program that I had been in for 2 years, I had started OCAD at the time, but I was in one of the back rows of the service, and he actually kind of outed me. Like, he was just like, we need to pray for this person who is, like, you know, lost her way. She was involved in our program, and now she's like struggling with homosexuality. And I was just like, wow. I'm just gonna quietly slip out right now, because I am really embarrassed.
Did they point to
you? Yeah, well, they said my name, and I just,
oh wow.
Yeah. Yep. So yeah, I definitely felt rejected. I think also, like, it was really confusing, because I was just like, I have wholeheartedly done everything I could to, you know, be connected. And I had confessed, I had been really vulnerable with the leader's wife about what I was going through. And then the fact that her husband kind of, I don't know, I felt extremely betrayed. And that was totally really confusing and really devastating. And I don't think I didn't process that at the time. I think I was just like, wow, I'm out. I feel so shitty.
Yeah. I think it's interesting just how social creatures we are, and how, you know, I mean, I think it's kind of like a youthful rebellious attitude that, at least that I know that I carried when I was younger. You know, just like, oh, I don't care what people think about me, and, you know, I'm my own person, and this and that, right? But the communities that you're involved in, you do care about what those people think about you, whether it's an art community or a religious community. And those things do matter. And to be ostracized and essentially exiled, to use like a biblical term, from a community is really devastating. And yeah, I mean, I guess, like, you know, I want to relate this also to what we were talking about before on the phone. You're saying that you would use the aspects of speaking in tongues, and maybe, you know, how about if you can describe what speaking in tongues is to people who might not know?
Okay. So speaking in tongues is something that the Pentecostal church believes is what happens when you're filled with the Spirit. So the Pentecostals are an evangelical sector of Protestants, and they really believe that, like, you can speak directly to God, and the Holy Spirit can also come upon you. And when this happens, an evidence that you're filled with the Spirit is that you speak in tongues, which is this, the Bible calls it like the language of angels. The way that I grew up to understand it was that it's an utterance of the Spirit. So when you don't know what to pray, you're kind of just like, it's like bubbling over with this kind of gibberish. It's more so just like an overflow of the Spirit. So when you don't know what to pray, it's your spirit just kind of praying with your vocal cords, I guess. Mm-hmm. Yeah. It sounds a little hokey.
Well, I mean, it's, you know, I think that it's really fascinating, essentially, these actions that, and the way that I could best understand it. Well, my business partner, he's an artist, and his wife is a medium. Yep. Her name's Asia Dasher.
Okay.
And she does this practice where she channels spirits essentially through an automatic writing practice where she scratches on paper and scribbles on paper, or at least what it looks like to me is scribbles on paper. And and it connects her to that. It's almost like opening a gateway up. And so, like, mm-hmm. I'm curious, with speaking in tongues, do you think that that transports you to your subconscious state of mind to be able to translate those feelings, that energy, into your artwork?
For sure. Yeah, 100%. I know that we talked about this in our previous conversation, that mm-hmm. one thing that I took with me is that's kind of still how I pray. So when I'm like, something's just like really pressing on me, or if I'm trying to meditate, it's just something that just happens. And it is for sure a way to connect with my subconscious.
So I'm curious about just you, like, have you always done abstract works, even from the beginning of when you started doing your art practice, or how has that transformed over time?
I would say that I've been an abstract painter probably right from the beginning. I've definitely dabbled in a few different, in some like landscape painting, but my grandfather was actually an abstract painter, and he was also a rug maker, and he taught me about abstraction. And the way that he did that is he had a farm that was about 20 minutes from where I grew up, and he would send me out into the back field and tell me to draw an abstract tree. So basically what he was telling me, I would come back with my tree, and he was really trying to get me to draw the essence of the tree, the energy of the tree and the feeling of the tree. And I remember the critique that he would give me is like, you know, this is okay, but it needs to be wilder. So he really taught me about trying to grab the essence of something. And he really helped me understand what abstraction was.
Do you feel that you've always been an intuitive person? Or would you consider yourself an intuitive person?
I would consider myself an intuitive, very intuitive person. And that's kind of the basis of abstraction, is using your intuition to kind of, I feel like my process is, it's really about color and it's really about the materials. And I feel that when I'm creating, I'm almost like an equal player to color and to the material, because as much as I'm manipulating color and material, it's also doing what it wants to do. And it's also just kind of creating itself and becoming itself. Mm. So I feel like it is a very intuitive process of just things unfolding themselves and becoming themselves. Mm. I know it's kind of abstract.
I mean, we are talking about abstract works. So, <Right. laughs> it is definitely abstract. Yeah.
Let me get clear.
I'm curious, in regards to the rug making that you also do, well, first of all, do you still practice that? And how did you get into that? And how is that process different from creating works abstractly through paint?
So I would say that I really have followed my grandfather's footsteps. He was an expressionist in the 50s and 60s, and he taught me how to use watercolor. He was also a rug hooker in the 50s, and he made these incredible, like, 14 foot by 12 foot rugs that were hand hooked. And they're just so incredible. And he kind of did a lot of color blocking as opposed to the folk. Like, when you look at the Canadian craft, you see that in the East you have these kind of like folky rug hookers who kind of are depicting narratives, and My grandfather kind of took it to the next level and did a very like modern spin on it with color blocking. So I was always surrounded by these incredible rugs. And so a few years ago, I started exploring the technique, and I tried hand hooking the way that he did. And I did about like a square inch in 2 hours. And it was just like, I don't understand how he made all of these incredibly large pieces. Like, he's just so meticulous and must have so much patience. So I ended up finding this hand tufting gun. So what it does essentially is it's motorized. It's kind of like a motorized sewing machine, and it shoots the wool into the backing, and it's a lot faster. So I started exploring rugs by hand tufting. And then I also have a manufacturer in India. And I would say that it differs from painting. It's still 2D, but it's interesting because it's more so like playing with color blocks as opposed to mixing. And it's a bit, you've got to be a bit more calculated.
Do you think that balances your mind out a bit to where you have certainty in a certain aspect where something is more calculated, and then with, let's say, the rugs, for instance, and where things can be more exploratory and you're exploring the unknown with the abstract? Or how would you view it?
That's a good question. I definitely find when I'm making rugs myself, it's very meditative. Yeah, it's just kind of methodical. Mm-hmm. Whereas painting is like you're in the moment and you've got to move fast because there's like water and texture, and you're just kind of like, yeah, there's just a lot of movement, and like I'm kind of in the painting. Whereas rugs is, it's much more calculated. So yeah, I would definitely say it balances it out for sure.
Hmm. Interesting. In regards to your newest show, have you been producing a lot of these artworks during the quarantine, or have you been producing them for the past year, or how long have you been working on these pieces?
So I started this body of work in mid-February, end of February. So there's a couple pieces that I had begun before everything kind of hit the fan. And I also titled the show Falling Forward, before everything kind of shit hit the fan. But I actually feel that the title has kind of elusively become part of this time period of just, you know, we've kind of just like fallen into a whole different world of like Zoom calls and just, yeah, we're in a totally different world now than we were a couple of months ago. So yeah, it's kind of crazy. The beginning part of the show, there was a lot of anxiety because I was like, I don't know, is it the Great Depression? Is everyone like, what's happening? There's just a lot of anxiety. And both of my shows, I had a show opening up in New York as well, and both shows got pushed back, which ended up being really good for me because the first month, I think I was telling you before, was just, I had a really, really hard time working because I come into the studio and I get a DM from Instagram or something, but then I just go down a rabbit hole of like everything that's happening. And the first few paintings were just really, really busy and chaotic and muddy. And I think it was because I was just so anxious and just so, it was reflecting kind of my state of mind at that time. So I kind of moved through that in the show. There's a couple of pieces that have been three different paintings because I was just like total brain, like, yeah, total beehive mind. And then I was just like, you know what? I just got to do this. Like, I just got to push through this. So I would say that I've definitely had multiple, you can ask my partner, I've had multiple breakdowns, but it's also been really great to have this outlet to just still have my studio where I can come and continue to work and have space to be alone and just kind of push through it.
Totally. Yeah. Yeah. It's even interesting just to be aware of your work changing throughout that process of being in quarantine and having all of this anxiety and anxiety through the media being projected onto us, and then how we intake that. Have you kept any of those art pieces, or have you painted over them?
There's one that has kind of, there's pieces of the anxiety peeping out. Yeah, I had to work them out. It was just something that I was like, yeah, I had to work out. So they're not going to be in the show, or the visual portrayal of it won't be in the show, but it's there underneath.
It's always there underneath.
Yeah, it's always there underneath. Exactly.
Lurking in the shadows.
Yeah.
our anxieties of the world.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. I think it's also interesting in romantic relationships too. I mean, you were talking about, you know, with your partner being there and seeing your anxious moments and things like that. And I think it's really interesting, like how just romantic partners, they can see you through all of these things, and you might not even be conscious of how you're projecting yourself out.
Yes.
And you're just kind of going through it together, and how
how
that amalgamation of feelings could be either detrimental for a relationship, or how if it could grow from there. But I think, I don't know, I think it's really interesting just to think about just the idea of the intermingling of two people in a, in an intimate romantic relationship like that. I mean, do you think about that?
Yeah.
Often? I'm sure you do.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm definitely very grateful for the outside perspective. Yeah. Cause I was just like, oh my God, I hate everything. I hate every painting I made. I want to die. but it's really nice to be in quarantine with another person who's just like, okay, this is actually really great. And like, just have another perspective supporting you through it. I'm so grateful for that.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm so grateful.
Definitely. Yeah. Yeah. Are you still a practicing Christian now?
That's a tough question. I'm not a practicing Christian. If someone asked me if I was a Christian, I wouldn't say no. Cause my family's Christian. And I respect it. And it's like a family value that I have. Am I a practicing Christian? Yeah, I would say no. Like I believe in God, and I believe that God is nature, and God is this creative force. And I don't think that we have all the answers. And I have a very strong sense of faith, and I'm still developing it, and I'm still kind of confused, but I definitely have my roots in Christianity and my spirituality, but I also am really open to, I'm open to a lot of different things. I'm open to different practices and different ways of connecting to the spirit. It's not just, I don't believe that it's like Christians are the only people who know how to connect with God. I think there's many ways, and I have found that it's really connecting through nature. It's connecting to nature is the fastest way to connect to your subconscious and to get underneath what's really happening. And I think that's really like a lot of what my work is about. It's about painting the what's happening in the unseen. And I called my show Falling Forward because there's a sense of gravity in my work. There's a sense of movement, but there's not really, because it's abstract, there's no concrete composition. But I think that a lot of, even speaking in tongues, there's an influence there, because it's speaking in tongues is an utterance of the spirit. And I think that abstraction is kind of the same utterance of this unknown, this mystery of life that's just like, you know, that's gravity, it's like the wind, it's like all of these things that we can't see. It's even this virus that's a part of nature that's just, it's completely upheaved our lives, but we can't really see it. We can see what it's doing. And that's really my interest, is painting this energy, this kind of like secret, there's like this invisible creator. And I think that that's why I say that I really feel that I'm an equal part as far as my paintings go. Like I'm an equal part with the color and with the materials. I'm just happen to be playing with these incredible elements. And when people ask me what my work is about, it's hard to answer that in a concrete way, but very simply put, I think that my work is really about color, and color is, it's in our daily lives. And I think that's the fun part of being an artist, is that I get this opportunity to play with color and play with the relationships that two different colors have together and how they might vibrate together. and putting shapes in negative space and how that feels and how they feel together and how they feel apart. Yeah, so I kind of went on a bit of a tangent. But yeah, my work is really about this unseen creator, which is this energy, which is really what life is. It's this, you know, we're just kind of falling into life, and we're coming up against so many things, and it's really, we really just need to surrender to them, right? It's, you can't stop life from becoming itself.
Yeah, I agree. Totally. Well, Janna, seriously, thank you so much for being open and honest and sharing your words. And yeah, it's been really a cathartic conversation.
Thank you so much for having me on your show.
Definitely.
I really enjoy speaking to you.
Me too. Yeah, I enjoy speaking to you as well.
Okay. Thank you so much, Yoshino.
All right. Thanks. Music for the podcast is by Rarebit, aka Justin Dosher Hopkins. Editing assistance is by Noah Wainwright, and intern is Sam King.